lead-based paint is with Oregon Health Authority, and the contractor's board has anything to do with the contractors, and our site development inspector has to do with the inspections. So, thank you, everybody, for being here. We'll go right into it. So, just a really brief overview, what's SB or Senate Bill 871? It's a new state law, and it allows local jurisdictions like us as a city to adopt regulations to mitigate the impacts of asbestos and lead-based paint, specifically in residential demolitions. The asbestos regulations aren't new, but there is a new piece which allows us to require a copy of the asbestos survey. And the lead-based paint regulations are new, because prior to this, there were no lead regulations for demolitions, oddly. It was only for renovations. Where does Portland's, and understand, this is Portland, where does the ordinance apply? For us, it applies to all structures with 1 to 4 dwelling units, regardless of the zone, and the accessory structures on those sites. And accessory structure, this definition comes from the building code. That's why we took that. And it becomes effective, I know it's kind of weird, but it's no later than July 1st. We said July 1st, the city council wanted us to get it in place as soon as possible. So if we can get it in place before July 1st, then we will, yeah.
When you say 1 to 4 dwelling units, does that include manufactured dwellings?
No.
On that last slide, on the 1 to 4, does the primary residence have to be demolished for those ancillary?
Good question. No.
Buildings?
No. The accessory structures on those sites, even if it's only the accessory structure that's being demolished, the regulations apply. Because they can have asbestos and lead-based paint too. So some of the key pieces of this new requirement will be a demolition manager has to be designated for all of the projects, and somebody with the certifications, and Tim will tell me if these are not said right, but basically an asbestos inspector certification, and if you're a contractor, then performing the demolition, then that contractor has to have the certifications.
So the certification, the asbestos inspector, which you want, is an AHRA accredited inspector.
We'll go over some of the details on and if a subsequent slide doesn't answer your question or isn't clear, then let me know when we get to the certifications.
Yeah, the same question with regards to the certification level on the lead-based.
Right, and then I'll get good questions, and I'm trying to, on the overview part, just give you an idea of high level, here's what the new regulations are going to require. And then you have to have a demolition plan for the dust and site control. And one of the keys to this is the building permit for the replacement structure won't be issued until the demo permit is final, which is a new, it's a very different practice for us. Sure.
Is there a way to request for demolition to see if
yes.
there's...
Yeah. I mean, that's not the demo permit. So, I mean, you can always go into the house. Anything that doesn't... Doing that testing doesn't require a permit. So you're always allowed to do that.
So what I'm saying is if there's a test, and a certain test, find that there's no asbestos or any other harmful materials.
Yes, always. Always. That's the current state of affairs. We have a demo permit now that's required. So the asbestos survey, the asbestos inspector, you have to have an asbestos inspector on site during all mechanical demolition and deconstruction activities. And the reason for that is we found we have a deconstruction ordinance that's been in place for a little over a year. And we found that even when a proper asbestos survey was done and the proper abatement was done, there in over 60% of the cases, there was still asbestos. So we want somebody with those, with that inspector accreditation on site. Also, the wind speed, if the wind speed exceeds 25 miles an hour, then no mechanical demolition activities can occur. This is called the lead hazard reduction portion. First, there has to basically be like a mini, an exterior deconstruction, if you will, of all painted exterior non-structural materials. Because we found that that's where most of the lead paint is. Yeah.
What if that material's been tested for lead by a qualified lab and there's no lead paint on the exterior?
If you can, we just did all exterior things have to be, all exterior painted materials have to be deconstructed.
Regardless of whether or not they contain lead paint?
That's the way it's written right now. If in discussions there's a way to have all of those tested, we'll see.
It seems super simple. We test it for it anyways, and it seems ridiculous that we pay for testing for exteriors of structures, and now we got to hire a totally separate crew to deconstruct a three-story building that doesn't have a lead paint.
Okay. We'll see if there's a way to look at that. I don't know if Ryan, if you have any thoughts on that.
I mean, there has to be a lead-based paint inspection, right, in order to exempt it.
Yeah. Right now, the way our ordinance is written is every surface has to be tested for you to be exempt from those requirements, and that would include the interior. So, that's a good question, and let me see if there's a way to.
I think at this point it would be important to inject that the person doing the testing is probably not the individual that he's already having there, because your ordinance requires a lead inspector or a lead risk assessor, not an LBPR licensed contractor, to ascertain whether there's lead or not present. And there are not many lead inspectors out there, so they're not currently using that level of inspection. And unless they have had that level, then you must assume by the ordinance that it is lead.
Right, and we're going to be developing admin rules, so some of this stuff we can drill down into and get into those details, because at this point the ordinance is a little more high level in that way. So, but those are good questions, and thank you for that. Materials that are pulled off in this mini deconstruction have to be put into 6 mil plastic and then placed in a covered container. During the removal, the 6 mil plastic while it's being removed, either the 6 mil plastic has to go from the base of the building 10 feet out, or if you prefer, or if you are too close to the property line, it has to go vertically. We've heard from contractors they'll hang it off the off the gutters or something like that, just basically to contain it, to keep it from getting onto the neighbor's property.
I'm sorry, when you talk about must be placed, or I'm sorry, so you're not looking for the demolished siding or whatever to go in a plastic bag and then go to the dumpster. It simply needs.
It does have to go into the. You've got two different things. What you pull off has to go into 6 mil plastic and put into a covered container, and you have to keep those materials basically from getting onto the neighbor's property by doing the.
Does it have to go into 6 mil poly at the point, 6 mil bags at the point of removal, or oftentimes those will line a dumpster and will take the material from the point of removal to a lined dumpster and put it in the lined dumpster. So the dumpster may be here in line. Mm-hmm. You're removing siding or the doors or whatever from here, you send the transport into a lined dumpster that's then sealed up for transport.
It sounds like it's going to be okay. Jeremy?
To clarify that, you're treating this as it's a contaminated material, you put down plastic, anything that comes off is to be placed on that liner, that 6 mil liner, not placed on top of the soil, then picked up and put into the dumpster.
Right. Yeah, it's going from the wall to a lined dumpster.
To a lined dumpster. But if you plan on stockpiling, that's where you need that.
Then it needs to be on. Then it needs to be on a ground cover, a 6 mil ground cover.
Correct.
Thanks. Okay, dust suppression. This is, what it says. Basically, you have to continuously wet the structure, the equipment, and the debris during mechanical demolition, transfer, and loading. We're not specifying how you have to wet it or what you have to wet it with. We tried to get that specific, but it really was too difficult, and so that's what the site development inspector is going to review. It'll depend on your site and what you say you've got and whether it looks like it's going to adequately contain the dust. Then the entire demolition site and the debris piles have to be wetted every day at the beginning and at the end of the day whenever mechanical demolition activities occur. So if you don't do mechanical demolition activities on that day, you don't have to wet it. And then the debris containment. So one half is dust containment, which is wetting it down. The other half is what happens with that when you wet it, it becomes water. So you have to contain the debris. Let's see. These are not new requirements. This is basically what's already required under our erosion and sediment control manual. Same with the stormwater or anything generated, you have to, if it's going to go offsite, you have to get the authorization to discharge, or you have to haul it offsite, and then you have to use the best management practices per Title 17, existing requirements, and then you have to cover any non-salvageable materials and debris at the end of the day with non-permeable plastic. That's basically, while you're doing the work to prevent it from going offsite. There is an exception if you do full deconstruction, and full deconstruction is defined as basically taking down 100% of the building, including everything, the core, the finishes, mechanical, electrical, plumbing, and then you can use machinery to move or process it. If you do full deconstruction, then you don't have to remove the exterior materials. You don't have to wet the materials, and you don't have to monitor the wind speed.
Well, if you're doing full deconstruction, aren't you removing materials anyway?
Yes, that's exactly right. So that's why you are exempt from that portion of the code that would say that you specifically had to do that. I'm just lining it up with the code.
So if I'm deconstructing the core of the building, then it's not necessary to containerize the siding and the door tram and all of that, is that correct?
Not as a separate thing. You are already deconstructing, so you don't have to, so you already are removing those.
Right, I'm talking now about containerization siding, window, trim, doors, balustrades, all of that. If I'm deconstructing the entire building, which includes the core, then does that mean that I don't have to package the siding and all of those other components as a part of the transport and disposal?
No, you do, and it's that's part of the deconstruction ordinance. So if you look at this ordinance, it points you to the deconstruction ordinance. So you have to comply with those requirements. So it's an either or.
Excuse me. Can you share the thinking behind not requiring the wetting of materials?
In deconstruction, in our deconstruction ordinance, you don't have to wet it down because you're pulling it down. You're not. It's the mechanical demolition that creates the dust. And the other part of it with deconstruction is a lot of times if you're trying to salvage the materials, and if you're wetting it, you're not going to be able to salvage the materials. I mean, we've found that with the deconstruction, it doesn't generate the dust.
So then, for instance, if my primary task is to mechanically wreck the building, but in advance of doing that, I'm taking off the siding and the window trim and all of that, then, you know, that's being pulled manually. Does that material need to be wetted while I'm, you know, if I'm wrecking the building, but I'm taking the siding off manually?
No, because the ordinance specifically says that you have to wet it down during mechanical demolition activities.
So
that's not a mechanical demolition.
So I don't have to wet it down during
Correct.
Pulling the siding and all of that?
That is correct, yeah.
But those components still need to be packaged?
Yes.
Foundation?
Yep. So even if you do full deconstruction, you still have to do the horizontal and vertical plastic protection to, you know, make sure that the neighbors are protected, and then wet, again, mechanically transferred. So if you take a piece of a wall and you move it, that has to be wetted while you're doing that. So there is an exemption for unsafe or hazardous structures, you know, sometimes to pull the siding and everything off, because sometimes either the site itself is particularly dangerous, you know, there might be like a bunch of needles or something like that, or the structure is in such bad shape that to do that would be dangerous. It's a pretty high threshold. You can only do that if you get a letter from a structural engineer from us, because there are situations where it falls under our code as a hazardous building, or a hazardous materials professional with supporting evidence documenting the condition of the structure and the reason why it's unsafe to remove those exterior materials. The demolition manager, that's the person, they are designated by the property owner, and they are the responsible person for implementing and overseeing the demolition plan. That's who our site development inspectors are going to be interacting with, making sure they're in compliance during the demolition. They have to either be an asbestos inspector and have the lead-based paint certifications, or they have to have that person on site.
So you're saying that's true even if the building's been tested and there's no asbestos present?
Yes, and the reason for that, like I say, is it goes back to our information from the deconstructions that 60% still had asbestos, so we want somebody on site who can handle that.
And does that inspector need to be on site consistently, or hey, there's a new layer, come on site, inspect, make your assessment, and leave, or someone have to be there?
No, they have to be on site during all demolition activities.
So let's say they come in and they take down walls,
uh-huh.
The inspector's there and says, that's some ducting, let's test that out.
Uh-huh.
But as they're working in that interior, that inspector doesn't have to be part of that.
I haven't.
If you come on site, he, she come on site,
uh-huh.
Make the inspection, leave, come back again on another layer, and then leave.
That's a good question. That level of detail would be something we'd be looking at in the admin rules. So, we'll be in touch anyway on the admin rules.
Okay. I'm sorry, I have another question. There is a threshold date when asbestos can generally be assumed to no longer have been in use. And so,
are you talking about years?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I'm taking, you know, for instance, if I'm taking down a building that was built in 1986.
I'm going to call on you, Zeb, on that one.
Yeah, DEQ does not have a cutoff date for commercial sites. They all require an asbestos survey,
right,
even if they were completed yesterday. And DEQ has no assumption that any cutoff.
I understand that, but this is really more the city's rules rather than DEQ's rules.
Yeah.
Or so.
There is no cutoff. We're not. Yeah. And the other point is the demolition manager is a responsible party in terms of enforcement, and that we'll talk about that later. These are the certifications, the asbestos inspector certification. It has to be an accredited inspector. The course basically to get this accreditation at this point is a 3-day course, 2.5 in class, half day, you know, field. And then there are two providers in the metro area, that information is in the handouts. And then if you have, it's a federal accreditation, so if you've got it from another state, that's fine, that's transferable. And then this link is in here, and if you go on our website and you click on that, it will give you those providers. So the lead-based paint certification requirements, this is out of the new admin rules from Oregon Health Authority. If the person performing the work is a contractor, they have to be certified as one of these four: asbestos worker, project designer, supervisor, or certified renovator. However, there is only available at this point in time in Oregon the certification for a renovator. So that's why that's the only one that's up there. But if you already have one of the other three, that's fine. And again, these are the websites that have that information on the courses. There are lots of these, and they're pretty available in your materials. It actually has some of the upcoming certification times for that.
Can we go back to that last slide for just a second? So the manager for the site needs to be an accredited, a HERA accredited asbestos inspector and a certified renovator?
No. The demolition manager has to either be certified or have somebody on site, and they're responsible for making sure that that person's on site when the person needs to be on site.
I understand, but the certified renovator, I'm sorry, I'm just not understanding the slide for you. So the lead paint certification requirements to be an asbestos abatement worker or asbestos abatement,
lead paint. This is lead paint.
Lead paint. So either a lead paint abatement worker, supervisor, project designer, or renovator.
Yeah.
To be any of those.
Yes.
Yeah, but your demolition manager needs to have both certifications.
Or have somebody with those certifications on site.
Okay.
That's it. They're like the, you know, they're like the project manager essentially. So they can have them. You know, it depends on your site and what you're doing.
And so then the demolition manager would not need to be on site physically all the time if they have those representatives on the site?
Correct.
Okay.
But you have to have both, is that correct, on
site? Yes.
Okay.
So for, this is new. We're having, right now we only have one inspection for our demolitions, and it's a post-demolition inspection. Now we are having three inspections. One is pre-demolition, where they look at the demolition plan. The second one is during the demolition, and the third one is basically the same one that we do right now.
Can I ask how heavily you're staffed for that?
That's a good question. One of the big reasons why our implementation date isn't until, you know, up to July 1st is because we are hiring three new site development inspectors to handle that. We have Jeremy and one other person right now, and we will be hiring one more that's already in the queue and two more that will be coming up.
And there's oftentimes on these, on a demolition project, you know, particularly if it's a single family residence, we're in and out in 2 days, maybe
right.
Three.
Yep.
And so how do you anticipate now? You know, so let's say it's a 3-day job. So there's a pre.
Right.
Are you going to be able to have enough staff to have somebody there the first day, the second day, the third day?
Absolutely. That's the intent. Yes. Yeah.
How does that fit with the FIR program?
Yeah.
It's still going to be they're going to go through this. And demolitions aren't part of the FIR program anyway.
No.
So it won't impact the FIR program at all, because if you're a demo, you don't belong in the FIR program, right? So this is looking at the ordinance from the chronological standpoint. So when you come in and you are applying for your demolition permit, you need to bring in this documentation. You have to bring in the demolition plan, a copy of the asbestos survey, and if I think it's friable asbestos is found, is that the way it works out?
both.
Both, okay. If any asbestos is found, then, you know, whatever you did to mitigate that and, or, I don't, that's not the right word, abate. And the closing letter that basically shows what you did. So we're gonna be creating a cover sheet for our asbestos survey so that our permit techs can take them in quickly. And, you know, that the applicant will need to fill out that'll basically say, you know, date of the survey, was asbestos found, yes or no? If so, where was it found? And when was it abated? You'll have to bring in the asbestos inspector certifications and the lead-based paint renovator certifications, or if you have another one of the authorized certifications for lead-based paint. If you say that it's in a pre-78 house, that there is no lead-based paint, then you need to provide verified test results showing there aren't any. And, you know, getting to your question there, we'll look at that as we get into the admin rules to see if we can parse that out between the internal and external. Notify BDS if you're gonna claim an exemption for unsafe or hazardous structure, if you know it at the time. And then I just wanted to alert you, there is a new, an additional 180 fee for, in addition to our existing demolition fees, and this is to cover the new staff. And the properties within, right now, if you're a 1-2 family that's being demoed, then you have to provide notice to the 10 surrounding properties. Now it's, for all the 1-4s, it's gonna be 300 feet. So we will be providing a list. You'll have to do door hangers on the properties within 300 feet. We'll provide a list and the door hangers. Then the demolition plan. Basically, these are the basic components of the demo plan. The name and the contact information for the demo manager. What techniques and equipment you're gonna use to control the dust and debris. The anticipated time frame for the demolition, so that we can do the scheduling, the description of the site control measures, basically what's on our simple site control form, and then the monitoring processes that will be followed on site. What we anticipate doing is creating a form that will help out so that you can, you know, it'll have the most common techniques and equipment so that you can do a checkbox to make that process go as fast as we can. And then if you're using something different, you would just note that. You also have to do any details on pedestrian protection if it's required, the how it's gonna be secured against unauthorized access, and then the erosion and site control measures. These are the ones that are already required. This slide basically is a comparison of, you know, what's new and how does it fit with our current regulations. Right now, again, the door hangers are only posted on the 10 surrounding properties. This will have to go to the properties within 300 feet. Right now, the door hangers, it says no sooner than 5 days before the demo. Now it's a time frame, no sooner than 2 weeks and no, you know, 2 weeks to 72 hours. Then the other piece on the 1-2 family, only on the 1-2 family, because of the asbestos survey being part of the intake materials and because of the lead-based paint requirements, there will no longer be a certification regarding asbestos and lead-based paint. And we will still provide the written notice to the surrounding properties within 150 feet on the 1-2s because that's for demolition delay. And then that still applies. The additional structures that are covered by this, the 1-4s, anything over 200 square feet, and now it includes the 3-4, including the mixed use. So 3-4s is new on this. But on those, no delay or mailed notice, and you do need to post properties within 300 feet. So now once you get your, you know, you get through the intake, then it goes to plan review. This is gonna be a little different, and I think this is how this is gonna go. Don't hold me to this, but this is how we've been talking about it going. Instead of going to a regular plans examiner, which is what it does now, we anticipate that it's going to go to the site development inspector, who's going to be the reviewer. So you'll have one person. It's almost more like the FERC program. And then once they review the documentation, then the next step will be the pre-demolition inspection. That's going to be an on-site inspection that where the site development inspector will look at the demo plan, confirming the certifications, providing posting for the erosion control. We already have that. That's already a requirement, but that's going to go earlier in there, and they'll provide that poster for you. Reviewing the, you know, what are you going to do for your lead hazard reduction, ensuring that they have a wind monitor, getting the dates of the demolition if you've got them, and then notifying the demolition manager again that they won't get the permit for the new construction until the demo permit is final. During demolition, or the second inspection, they're going to go on site and basically make sure that everything that you said you were going to do, you're doing. That, you know, you've got your equipment on site and using it properly. That, you know, you are or have done the partial deconstruction, the dust suppression is on site, and that the wind speed at that time doesn't exceed 25 miles an hour, and that you have your containment pieces on site, and that you're covering it.
The 25 miles per hour for wind speed, how are we determining that? Is that
you need a monitor. I've heard that they're like $25 at Home Depot. So and our site development inspectors will have one too. But you have to have one. That's one of the pieces in the pre-demolition inspection, is they're going to confirm that the demolition manager that they have that monitor.
And is that just gust or constant?
Well, it's when you test it, you know.
Okay.
And if at any point, you know, it's exceeding it, you know, you need to stop those activities. So if it's a gust, for example, you would stop, and then if you retested and it went below, you know, you wouldn't have to stop for the whole day if it's, you know, if there's only like 2 hours where it's above 25 miles an hour.
Okay.
I understand that you can't issue the building permit until this whole process is going. But can it be done simultaneously while the building permit is going through the process, and this be done, or do you have to do all this before you apply?
I think you can put in the application. I don't know if I get.
You can put in the application and apply for the permit. It can be approved issue. You just won't be able to issue it
right
until the other
one
is finalized.
Okay.
Thank you. Let's see. Were there any other questions on this one? So then the post-demolition inspection, it's going to verify that, you know, this is similar to what we already do right now. That the site grading's been completed, that any soil stabilization measures that you have to do have been completed, and that the premises are secured, as you've said, in the demo plan. Enforcement, stop work orders, it's the same process as we do right now. If you're violating it, then we'll post it. Then we will be issuing correction notices. That's what we typically do. That's the first step, and that's basically, you know, what did you do, what's the code section, you know, what do you need to do to correct it. If you get the correction notice and you don't correct it, or, and this is key, or if the same responsible party is found to have violated any provisions of the ordinance on a different project, we can issue a citation. What we're trying to get at here is, you know, probably everybody in this room is a good actor. You know, you're here, you're learning, you're trying to do the right thing, but we all know there are plenty of actors out there who aren't. And we're trying to keep it so that somebody can't go from site to site. And, you know, our typical citation process would follow the owner. or somebody could be in an LLC and then just change the name of the LLC, but it's the same person going from property to property, not complying with these regulations. So that gives us the ability to hit any responsible party, which includes the property owner, the person authorized to act on the owner's behalf, the demolition manager, any person causing or contributing to a violation, and it'll be at the discretion of the inspector who will be cited. Yeah.
So, say you do encounter a bad actor who's done poor practices. The lead has spread approximately 300 feet with the house in the center of that circle. That's maybe 50 properties impacted. What correction will be required of the responsible party?
What's that? Yeah, I mean, you know, the responsible party, the enforcement capabilities that we have are this. The first offense will be a $5,000 fine, the second offense will be $10,000, the third will be $15,000. And, you know, if the neighbors can prove, you know, that that's happened, then they can bring a personal lawsuit, but we don't have that enforcement capacity. So these, you know, we're not trying to fine people, we're trying to get people to comply. So, you know, with the correction notices, we're you know, trying to do as much education and outreach as we can to get people to understand what the requirements are. And, you know, that first correction notice is, you know, certainly people are going to get out there and they're not going to know that these requirements are there. They're not going to quite understand them, and that's fine. We understand that. But once you know, once you've been cited once, you know, then you're on notice. Hey, these regulations are out there. You got to take them seriously. So we've made the fine structure, you know, pretty significant if you are a repeat offender. So now what's next? We're going to be developing the administrative rules, and the admin rules basically are going to go into more detail. They're going to address things like, you know, what this gentleman brought up in terms of, you know, what if you've tested the outside? Will that mean then that you, you know, don't have to do that exterior deconstruction? And what does that mean? What is sufficient testing? Because one of the issues that we discussed with Oregon Health Authority and DEQ was, you know, a lot of times you can test the outside pretty simply, but three layers down, there's lead-based paint. So how do we deal with those kind of situations? The implementation, again, it will be by July 1st when we have the people, you know, hired, and we're seeing what the time frame on that is. We have some pretty significant computer changes that we have to make to accommodate for the inspections and some of those other pieces. Once we have a better idea, then we're gonna you know, get that word out as soon as we can. Yeah.
I have a question with regards to your administrative rules.
Hang on, let me get this one back here first.
Does the effective date apply only to new permits after the effective date?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
That would be that one.
You said you're going into an administrative rule making process.
Yes.
You know when that'll be complete? When will actually have, I guess my take on this is an overview of the intended process, but you know, the devil's always in the details of administrative rules.
Sure.
So are you already in the rule making process in terms of developing the administrative rules? If you're not, are you anticipating including anyone from industry as part of the advisory group?
I would love to have anybody, you know, anybody here who wants to be part of that process, who wants to be included. It is a public process anyway, and we'll put it out. But I would love to have anybody who would like to be part of that process to do that. That would be great.
There's a couple people here.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, on the admin rules. It's the devil's in the details. Exactly. We're gonna, you know, go into some of these pieces, and the other part of it with the admin rules, it does give us the flexibility. We do have to go out for a public process, but it doesn't have to go back to the city council. So if we, you know, create the admin rules and we find out 3-6 months down the line that, oh, that really didn't work, we have the flexibility to go back and change the rules, and that helps us a lot. To answer your question about the timing, what I'll be drafting the rules. I'm collecting, issues that need to be addressed in there. So that's where I'm at in the process. I've been trying to work on like our computer programming piece to make sure that that's moving in a timely fashion so that it's up and running when we need to. So as soon as I get that piece done, then I'm gonna start focusing on the admin rules, and then we'll have a better idea when the implementation date will be. And then the other pieces, I just wanted to toss this out there because our requirement to have a copy of the asbestos survey, et cetera, that's unique to us, but I just want to remind everybody that DEQ does have other rules governing asbestos, specifically the transportation and disposal of asbestos-containing material. And sorry that there's a typo on that. DEQ is going to be starting to require asbestos surveys for renovations, which is different.
And that is specifically for residential renovation.
Yeah.
And DEQ currently requires on commercial sites an asbestos survey for renovations.
How do you define residential? Is it 1 to 2s?
1 to 4.
1 to 4s. Okay. So, yeah, it'll be the same projects that are coming here.
So will that information, your the asbestos report for renovations, have to go with your PER permit when you?
We haven't talked about
or
that
where
at
you,
all.
Where
yeah.
Do you get that
yeah.
to and when?
No, I mean, it's just, you know, DEQ is just in the rulemaking process, and I only know this because I happen to be on their stakeholder group. The rules haven't gone out to public comment yet. I just kind of, you know, I want to be doing my bit as and doing the outreach part because this is going to be a pretty big change. Yeah.
I believe you mentioned that the requirement for having the asbestos monitor on site for the entirety of the process was that 60%, you guys found that during deconstruction, 60% of the house that was deconstructed had asbestos still in them.
Uh-huh.
Is there a process or do we have to do anything if asbestos is found during the demolition? Do we have to notify you? Do we have to?
Well, that's a...
Yeah. So for DEQ, even though you've had an asbestos survey conducted,
yep.
asbestos containing material was identified, you hired a licensed abatement contractor, had it removed,
yep.
you're starting to demolish the facility, if at any point there is suspect material that was not sampled, you're required to stop, sample that material, and if it is asbestos containing material, you're actually required to notify DEQ.
Okay.
So DEQ is notified. Do you notify the city or do we
yeah.
have to tell you as well? Which is sort of your question.
Yeah,
who do we have to tell?
But yeah, is there anything above and beyond what we already have to do with DEQ? Do we have to notify the inspector?
I wasn't anticipating that, you know, as long as you do what's required from DEQ to data, that's, you know, essentially what we're looking at.
Is that notification online? Is it a phone call? Is it an email? Is there how does it work?
All the above.
And drive down to their office.
Well, that's exactly why we want somebody who is a certified inspector, because they're going to know, they should know the answers to those questions.
Question, this is mostly pertaining obviously to getting a demolition permit as part of a building permit.
Uh-huh.
Can you define what demolition is for you? Because sometimes it's alteration or it's a load-bearing wall or what?
So we're actually working on, we have a definition in our code right now, but before this goes live, we're changing the definition, we're trying to simplify it. It's basically going to be, you know, if city council approves this, it'll be, you know, taking down all four walls. And
so scraping a building or raising a building.
Yeah, I mean, that's essentially what it is now.
Okay.
Yeah, that's essentially it. Yeah, I mean, right. Any other questions?
Just to make sure I understand, until July the 1st, old rules are in effect.
Or the implementation date, whichever comes first. Because we were told by the city council to, if we can get it live before July 1st, that we need to. So, but we will, you know, send out information of when it's going to go live. And to that point, right now on our website, unfortunately, because of the way the ordinance was adopted, it was adopted as an emergency ordinance. So when you go onto our website and you look at the demolition ordinance, it shows the ordinance as it's going to be in effect July 1st. It doesn't show the current, that got taken off because it was adopted as an emergency ordinance. So from a legal perspective, it technically was effective immediately, but we're not implementing it until July 1st. So there's a little bit of confusion. We've been working with the auditor's office to put a caveat on there that basically says it's not in effect yet, and a link to the current requirements.
How will we be notified if the effective date becomes, or if the effective date turns out to be before July 1? Because obviously there's a lot of planning that goes into place. I mean, if just in order to get ready for the contractor's position. And so if suddenly the city's ready to implement this on May 3rd,
mm-hmm. We won't be.
Right, but you understand my question.
Absolutely, yes. So we will be sending it out to, you know, everybody who's here for sure. And, you know, we have pretty extensive email lists, and we'll be sending that out. And, you know, based on my continuing discussions with both the computer piece and the hiring and training piece, it's not going to be much before July 1st.
Okay.
Yeah.
To be clear, if demolition permit is submitted prior to implementation date,
right,
that will not be under these rules.
That is correct.
Current rules.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the current rules are on your website now, or going to be?
Well, yeah. I haven't checked the auditors. I haven't checked the website today. As of yesterday, we're working with the auditor's office for the solution, so I don't know how long it will take them to get that up there with the link. But, you know, hopefully by Monday, the correct ones will be back up. You look like you're about to raise your hand now. Okay. Any other questions? You know, we have Tim Linehan with the contractor's board. If you have any questions, you know, contractor-related questions, and we have Zeb with DEQ, and we have Ryan with Oregon Health Authority. Do any of you have any comments, any corrections, anything? Yeah, Tim, please.
I just want to make one quick comment that we discussed throughout this process. Just to be clear, this is a city ordinance that the state does not enforce. I have no authority during demolitions to act on lead-based paint violations. Contrary to that, DEQ still has authority with demolition monitoring. So just know that your compliance issues with this ordinance are with the city and not with the state. I'm not much help when it comes to demolitions. Earlier, we talked about the definition of a demolition. And if a wall is remaining on the project, that is a renovation. And I do have jurisdiction on all renovations, so that information we would be interested in. However, demolitions, we can't pursue because I have no authority.
So to clarify, we need to get the state training to become a certified renovator, but we don't need to register with the state as a certified renovation firm.
So my understanding with Nancy is they're going to require that you be a certified renovation firm in order to obtain the demolition permit. So you would have to register with us, register that accreditation.
As a firm, not just as an individual.
Correct.
I mean, for
us,
that's
my understanding.
As a firm?
That's
so
different than what you said.
Here's how the process works. Is I'm an employee of ABC Renovation, and I take a renovator's course. I am now allowed to do renovator work. However, ABC Renovation is not allowed to do work until I register my certification with that firm as an employee or owner or individual. Then that firm is then allowed to obtain permitting or engage in projects that involve lead-based paint.
So is that different? So from our perspective, we're that lead-based paint piece is driven by the SB 871 language. So my understanding is that what we're concerned about is that there's somebody on site with that certification. So we don't really care if the firm is registered.
So that's different than what, so you guys have a disagreement.
No. It's her statute,
yeah.
It's the city statute. They're gonna enforce and apply it. Just know that if it was a renovation, obviously the firm needs to be.
Totally, I get that.
Okay.
But if I'm an excavation contractor, I don't need to become a certified renovator. I just need to get my lead-based paint certification as an individual or something in my crew.
Right.
Okay.
Questions? And that brings me, I want to point out something, a really big difference in how we define demolition versus how DEQ in its regs defines demolition. You probably know the definition off the top of your head.
Yeah, so DEQ's definition of a demolition and Oregon administrative rule and asbestos requirements are if you are impacting a load bearing. That's defined as a demolition.
Wow.
And all demolition work practice requirements are.
Yeah, just so you know that, to add confusion, that's a problem when you've got different jurisdictions, but I mean, that's their definition. So
and what's
that's
going
to kick in the requirement for an asbestos survey. It's not necessary, we won't look at that because that's not going to kick in, you're not going to be coming in for a demo permit if all you're doing is something to a load-bearing wall. So it won't kick in our requirements. But just be aware that there's a different definition and that doesn't affect DEQ. Yeah.
Does the city of Portland have a sister rule for commercial properties, or is there
any? No. All of the discussion, both at the state level and at the local level, has been on the residential. We've expanded it up until now. Residential for us was 1 to 2. This is going to 1 to 4s. The reason why we haven't done anything beyond that is because we simply haven't had, number one, we haven't had direction from council to do that, and number two, we haven't had the right stakeholder group because, you know, we've been sitting down with the residential, mainly the single family contractors, so we would need a different stakeholder group to talk about, because like, for example, how do you post properties with a door hanger, if you're downtown, doesn't make a whole lot of sense. So, good question. Any other questions? Yeah.
So, unlike the city's deconstruction ordinance that carried with it some sort of incentives, this doesn't appear to have incentives. So, has the city looked at the impacts that would cause for companies that have to compete with each other to get bids and actually stay afloat and keep the business running? Not incentivize them actually being and determining bad actors just to do a job.
Have we incentivized? I'm not sure.
Like, what is the city doing to not make this a financial hardship? Or has the city run this through the equity lens to see how we're not impacting small businesses, people we're trying to get into or stay in the workforce?
That's a good question. It's kind of a double-edged sword. One hand, it opens up, kind of like the deconstruction did, it opens up more opportunity for, people to get into, lines of work and, be able to do some other things. So there is an opportunity there. The additional cost is, the cost of getting your people certified or, hiring somebody to do that. Yeah, I mean, We've looked at it as much as we could through the equity lens. The difficulty is this was mandated to us, you know, to do by the state in terms of the lead paint piece of it. And the asbestos piece, all we're doing is requiring a survey to come in, and that actually has been an equity piece because it'll make that survey available to anybody who wants to see it. But there, yeah, there are going to be some impacts, and you know, we can't, you know, so far we haven't you know, gotten any different direction.
Well, the cost, I mean, it's pretty simple. The cost increase is borne by the property owner because right. much of the instead of coming and wrecking the building completely by machine, you're dismantling a portion of a person. There's the labor cost of the homeowner burden, the property owner is burdened with for the additional labor and
right. labor costs. And the you know, the equity piece, it's kind of a weird balance because you have a lot of the, if you look at Portland maps and you see where a lot of these demolitions are occurring, it's in the, you know, traditionally, you know, minority or lower income neighborhoods, a lot of them. And there have been no protections, and so the only people who have really been able to get protections against the asbestos and lead-based paint have been people who have enough money to, you know, like test before and after, or you know, do some of these other things. So, you know, it's a balancing.
So I'm sorry to go back to the inspector and certified requirement. Is that only when there is material still on site? So I'm not gonna have my demo, let's say I pulled all the building down, my building materials are off site now, I have it now I'm into my foundation, do I still need that inspector on site? The inspector and sort
of. Oh, I see what you're saying, yeah. I mean, those are the kinds of details that we're gonna be looking at in the admin rules.
Okay.
And again, you know, love participation from people here. Yeah. Perfect.
Where's your contact info? We want to reach out to you and see if that's the whole process.
So I have my cards.
Okay.
Cool. So I'll just leave them up here. And that would be great. Any other questions? Well, thank you everybody for coming, and again, my cards are up here.